cannot take the grace of God for granted. Many people started this year with us. Even as our last month in August, many people still died. But you are alive today. Your family members are alive today. We give God praise. We give him honor. He that who has started a good work in your life is faithful. He will see us through in the name of Jesus. Happy new month. This is a month that Lord will do great and mighty things in our lives. And you will put testimony in your mouth in the name of Jesus. The 9 month is a month of manifestation. It's a month of delivery. That is, whatever you are trusting God, the Lord will cause them to become manifested in the name of Jesus. We give praise and honor to the Lord in Jesus' name. Today we'll be looking at Moses, a man of destiny. The digging deep today is a continuation of what we've been looking at for the past 6 weeks. Today we'll be looking at Moses, a man of destiny. Part 7. Moses, a man of destiny. Part 7. May God bless us as we listen to his word in Jesus' name. The text will be taken from Exodus chapter 12. Exodus chapter 12. We'll look at verses 1 to 13. We'll not look at everything. I'll just pick some verses in there. Exodus 12, 1 to 13 will be our text, but I'll not read everything. Let me start from verse 2. This month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Verse 3. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month, they shall take to themselves every man a lamb, according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. Verse 5. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You shall take it out of the sheep or from the goats. Verse 6. And you shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month, and all assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. Verse 7. And they shall take of the blood and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper door post of the house, wherein they shall eat it. The verse 8. And they shall eat the flesh in that night, toast with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Verse 10. And you shall let nothing remain until the morning, and that which remaineth of it until the morning you shall burn with fire. Verse 11. And thou shalt eat it with your loins girded, your shoe on your feet, your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it in a haste. It is the Lord's Passover. Verse 13 and the last verse. And the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where ye are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt. That was what God promised the children of Israel. And the same promises are true for us today, because the promises of God are yea and amen in Christ Jesus. None of the destruction will come near your dwelling in the mighty name of Jesus. By the reason of the blood of Jesus, the angel of death will pass over you and your families in the mighty name of Jesus. Let's quickly have a recap of what we had the last time, the sixth part. We learned there about the incident of the rod that became a serpent. It tells us something clearly, that God can do anything. Beyond the fact that God can do anything, it also teaches us that if you surrender anything to God, he can transform it to something mighty, something wonderful, and that thing that we've given unto God, no matter the state of that thing, will become a mighty weapon in the hand of God to be used for his glory. Today, we'll be looking at the first Passover in the Bible, which we read through earlier on, Exodus 12 verses 1 to 13, or to the end. May the Lord bless us as we look at his word today in the mighty name of Jesus. Introduction. There are basically three feasts the Lord of heaven commanded the Israelites to celebrate. There are three basic feasts that we can pick from the Bible, major one now. The first was Passover, the second is the Pentecost, and the third is the Feast of Tabernacle. I'll go through that again. There are three major feasts that God commanded the Israelites to celebrate. The first is the Passover, which we'll be looking at today. The second one is the Pentecost. And the third one is the Feast of the Tabernacle. All these three feasts are interwoven, and they are related with other smaller feasts around them. But most importantly, we must bear in mind that these three feasts are the most predominant. And each of these feasts, they have incredible significance in the Old Testament, likewise their fulfillment in the New Testament. For instance, the Passover has its significance in the fact that the burial, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ was basically a typology that we have in the Passover. So God established the Passover as a means of delivering his people from the land of Egypt, from the bondage of Egypt, and from slavery. After nine plagues, God used nine plagues to try and show to Pharaoh and his people that he was God in heaven and he was intervening in the affairs of men, and they did not even recognize. But there was a last straw that brought the camels back, and that was the 10th plague, which had to do with the death of the firstborn of all families in Egypt, as well of the cattle and every living thing. That was just the Haima, because this is a culture that worshiped the first son and the first child. So that was a major one for them, and they were able to do what they could see, that this is God. And that made Pharaoh to have a temporary, I would say, release. I said, okay, you guys can go, just go. Even though he dilly-dally, he had issue with them, oh, you go without your children, you go without this and all of that, eventually he allowed them to go. You can get all of this in Exodus chapter 7, Exodus 7 from verse 14 to Exodus chapter 10, verse 29. We can see that the final plague was what God used to provoke king of Egypt to release the children of Israel to serve God. So what do we learn from the Passover? If you look at the passage of this children of Israel, or the deliverance of Israel from the land of bondage, it did not just happen, but something happened prior to that period. They did something a night before, and that was the Passover they did. And what did that Passover tell us? Clearly telling us what are the things that they needed to do. That the Exodus chapter 12 we read earlier on, or I read to us earlier on, we have there the unleavened bread. This was essential in the Passover of the people, because they did not even have the time to start thinking of mixing the dough they have with yeast so it can rise. They did not. They had to do everything in a hurry. They said they had to do it in a haste. They had to go the next day, so they just had to make whatever they had at that material point in time. So the blood of the Passover, even though it was not consumed, but it played a pivotal and a critical role in the deliverance of Israel. How? They had to put the blood on the lintel, on the doorpost of their houses. And the Lord said, when I see the blood, I will pass over. That clearly says that as many people that were Israelites, as many people that were Christian, if they can plead the blood of Jesus upon their situation, it does not matter the pandemic ravaging the world today, it will not come near your dwelling in the mighty name of Jesus. So that angel of death knew where to go. He knew where to avoid. He knew where to not go to. Praise the name of the Lord. So in doing this, the Israelites, and as Christians today, we mark ourselves as God's property. We mark ourselves as people that God has delivered and purchased with his blood. Therefore, nothing can take us from the hand of God. Praise the name of the Lord. So the Lord provided a way of escape for his children, and he's provided a way of escape for us today in our society, in our time, in the name of Jesus. Ultimately, the Passover was a pointer to something bigger, something greater than the lamb that was sacrificed on that first day. Praise the name of the Lord. That clearly tells us that Jesus Christ ultimately would deliver us eternally from the power of sin. Praise the name of the Lord. And from the terrible judgment that we otherwise would have received for the sin we have committed. Because he had no sin. And he had to bear our sin upon himself. And he died for us because of the love that he left. For God so loved that he gave his only begotten son. And whosoever believeth in him will not perish, but they will have what? Everlasting life. So Jesus is the author. Is the resurrection and the life. In John 11:25-26, John 11:25-26, Jesus says something that is very profound. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me will live, even though he dies. And none of us will die in Jesus' day, but whoever lives and believeth in me will never die. That was what he said to the sister of Lazarus when they came to, don't worry, he's dead already, 4 days, he's gone, buried. So many people are saying, no, there's nothing happening, everything is gone, 2020 is the worst year thus far. But for children of God, we're going to say, no, this is going to be our best year, because God say, when men say there's a casting, that we're saying what? There's a lifting up for us in the mighty name of Jesus. So through John 11:25-26, Jesus clearly assures us that when the judgment of God will come upon the world, believers, Christian, you and I, if you are called by the name of the Lord, we will be saved by the blood of the Lamb in the mighty name of Jesus, provided we put our trust and our faith in that work that Christ has done for us. The redemptive sacrifice of Jesus, we identify with the work he has done on the cross for us, and we have faith in our Messiah, Jesus Christ. I pray the Lord will grant us grace to walk in this in Jesus' name. Jesus Christ is the Lamb of God. John 1:35-36 clearly tells us that. John 1:35-36 clearly tells us that there was no other person that could have done that. John the Baptist was a forerunner of Jesus. He said, "Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the whole world." So if you are in doubt as to the Lamb of God, Jesus is the Lamb of God. Jesus is the sacrificial Lamb of God to die in place of us as people that have sinned against God, that have broken the law of God, and as the Passover of the first Passover made the people of Israel to be saved from the calamity, from the destruction that came upon the land. We also, as Christians today, we have that same opportunity, that golden opportunity to be called by the name of the Lord. I pray the Lord will bless us and grant us grace to understand deeper in the name of Jesus. So the question is, what is the background to this Passover? What is the history of Passover? The feast of Passover is celebrated every year by Israel. And basically, it is a remembrance of that which God did in the first Passover. They were all in bondage. They have lost hope. God promised Abraham, your children are going to be numbered on it. They will not be able to number them. They're going to be mighty upon the earth. And lo and behold, they were in bondage for 430 years. And they'd be like, are you sure God will come through for us? But our God is a faithful God. At the appointed time, God came through for them. Praise the name of the Lord. And that clearly tells me that God will come through for each and every one of us in Jesus' name. So this clearly tells us how God used Moses as a man of destiny to deliver the people of Israel from bondage. And everything that hitherto hindered you as children of God, our God is able to deliver us from them in the name of Jesus. God will give the devil the last blow that will lead to his destruction and all your celebration in Jesus' name. The first Passover is also a foreshadow, is a pointer to a greater thing, which is the Passover Lamb of Jesus Christ. Jesus is our perfect Passover. The first Passover, just point out, is a typology. It's something that God used as a symbolic representation of that which to come later. It's like a shadow of the greater thing to come. Praise the name of the Lord. So it was pointing to the ultimate picture of Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Lamb, who will be killed, who will be crucified to save us, in order to purchase us by his blood. And he was able to destroy the power of death, because the angel of death could not kill us. And the angel of death will not kill any of us in the name of Jesus. He did not just deliver us from the angel of death, he has also translated us. He has also transferred us into the kingdom of his son. And that's the kingdom of light. He said he has translated us from the kingdom of darkness into what? Into the kingdom of light. Praise the name of the Lord. 1 Peter 2:9 will tell us that we are new creature and you are all of this. Praise the name of the Lord. So we are shining forth as the light of God in Jesus' name. So what is the prophetic significance of the Passover Lamb? The Passover Lamb, what does it stand to tell us? What do we learn from it? In Exodus 12:13, it said, "The blood shall be to you for a token upon the house where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt." Clearly, the significance of this for us is Jesus is being pointed to us as the ultimate sacrifice, as the ultimate lamb that will deliver us from the power of sin. In Mark 14:24, Jesus said, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. As many that receive him, to them he gave the power to become the Son of God." We'll find that in John 1. Leviticus 23:5 said, "The Lord's Passover begin at twilight of the 14th day of the month," like we saw in Exodus 12 as well. All of these things are very important on the 10th day, on the 14th day, and all of the activity that happened. Because when we get back to when Jesus was crucified, you will see the fulfillment of all of this happening to Jesus. The day he was crucified and the day he died, his bone was not broken according to the first Passover. Praise the name of the Lord. So clearly in Exodus 12:19, God expects us to be prepared before the Passover. Exodus 12:19 said, "For the seventh day no yeast to be found in your house, and anyone, whether foreign or native born, who eat anything with yeast in it must be cut off from the commonwealth of Israel, from the community of Israel." That tells us that cleansing, cleaning, holiness, purification must always be performed before Passover. In the olden days, it was done for 7 good days. No wonder when Jesus got to the temple and he saw them in John 2:13-16, when Jesus got to the temple before the Passover festival, he did what? He cleansed the temple. People were like, wonder why was he beating them? Because he saw the corruption of the moneylenders. They were there doing businesses in the house of God. You were like, no, this is the house of prayer. This is the house of my Father. You cannot turn it to what? A den of robbers. So that tells us that God knows, or Jesus knows the implication, the importance of the Passover. In John 2:13-16, I quickly read through that. I said, "The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. And he found in the temple those who were selling oxen and sheep and doves, and the money changers seated at the table. And he made a scourge of cords and drove them all out of the temple with the sheep and the oxen. And he poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their table. And to those who were selling the dove, he said, 'Take this away. Stop making my father's house a place of business.'" That was in accordance with the Jewish tradition as well as the Bible. Jesus also made preparation for Passover when he told his disciples in Luke 22:7-13. In Luke 22:7-13, Jesus told them, I'll read that scripture now. He said, "The day came of the unleavened bread on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John and said, 'Go and make preparation for us to eat the Passover.' They're now asking, 'Where do we want us to prepare for it?'" That clearly tells us you must prepare for Passover. It's not something you stumble into. He replied, "As you enter the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him to the house where he enters and say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks us, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciple? He will show you a large room upstairs, all furnished, all prepared, all made ready. Make preparation there.' They left and found things just as Jesus had told them." So they prepare the Passover. So clearly telling us that Jesus also knows the importance of Passover. In Romans, you find out that God expects us, from the study of the Word of God, you see that in Romans, they find out that the lamb must be slain on the 14th day. The lamb must be slain on the 14th day. And Jesus told them in Luke 22:15, he said, "I eagerly desire to eat this Passover with you before I suffer." Because he was aware that that was going to be the last supper. It was going to be the last Passover you will have with them. He said he desired to have the Passover with them before he suffer. So it was during this Passover that Jesus also inaugurated the new covenant with his disciples. When he said to them, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." So Jesus fulfill the requirement of the Passover lamb. What do we mean by that? We'll quickly go through some scriptures and examples of how Jesus fulfilled the requirement of Passover. In Isaiah 53 verses 5 to 6, "But he was pierced for our transgression, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wound we were healed. We were all like sheep. We have gone astray. Each one of us, we have turned to our own way. And the Lord laid on him the iniquity of us all." We must remember that Jesus was pierced for our transgression. The stripe of Jesus is the basis of our healing today. It was the lamp of God. It was the Passover lamp of God. And that clearly tells us the body of Jesus was the lamp that was pierced for our own sake. Jesus perfectly fulfilled the promise of the redemption that we found in the Passover. In the olden days, what they do, they would put their hands on the lamb, and they would transfer all of their sin upon that lamb, and the lamb would be slaughtered and would be at least put on the altar, and they would set fire upon it, and the fire would consume the sacrifice, and the sweet smelling favor would now go to heaven as a pleasant sacrifice unto God. But we'll look at how did Jesus fulfill the template the requirement to be a perfect lamb of God. The first thing we must bear in mind is the Passover lamb was meant to be chosen and set apart on the 10th day of the first month of Nisan. The Passover lamb was meant to be chosen and set apart on the 10th day of the first month of Nisan. If you remember when we were reading Exodus 12, we're talking about on the 10th day, on the 14 days, and all of that. So if you look at Jesus, Jesus rode to Jerusalem on a donkey, and he was hailed King of Jews on the 10th day. Jesus rode to Jerusalem on the donkey, and he was hailed King of Kings on the 10th day. The second significant thing we can see in terms of the fulfillment of Jesus, the lamb was meant to be inspected for 4 days. Until the 14th day of the month, for any spot or any blemish that may disqualify the sacrificial lamb. You keep it for 4 days, you check it out. Does it have any blemish? Does it have any wrinkle? Does it have any spot? Jesus openly taught in the temple and in the synagogues until the 14th day, and there was no fault found in him. Even Pilate said, I found no fault in him. The third point that we see in terms of Jesus's ability and the sacrifice of Jesus being a fulfillment of the Passover that we have read in Exodus. At the appointed time, the Passover lamb were meant to be slain by the whole congregation of Israel. At the appointed time, Jesus also, as the Lamb of God, was delivered and publicly killed by the Romans through execution. And that clearly tells us that the Passover lamb has been slaughtered. In Romans 3:25, God presented Messiah Jesus to us as the sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood. So a central lesson we can learn from the Passover lamb is that the shed blood caused the wrath of God to pass over. By the blood, we are saved. When I see the blood, I will pass over. The angel of death will pass over us. So as many of us that have faith in Jesus, we also do what? We have that opportunity to enjoy the blessing of God in spite of what we have done. Praise the name of the Lord. Passover is also an illustration of God's redemptive sacrifice and plan for humanity. Israelites were in bondage in Egypt, but when God intervened, God delivered them. Praise the name of the Lord. Jesus Christ gave us a lamb to be slaughtered, and he did that of his own free accord. He was not forced. Jesus said plainly, nobody took my life from me. John 10:17-18 said, nobody took my life from me. I willingly gave it for redemption. Jesus willingly gave his life for redemption. In 1 John 3:16, he said, this is how we know real love. Jesus gave his life for his brothers and for you and I. Praise the name of the Lord. So even Apostle Paul clearly emphasized the importance of Jesus as the Passover lamb. When you talk about the feast of Passover in 1 Corinthians 5:7-8, 1 Corinthians 5:7-8, Apostle Paul talked about the Passover lamb and Jesus being the Passover lamb for us. So the people of Israel, of course, understood the importance of the Passover lamb, and they are able to walk with it. Praise the name of the Lord. And of course, as I round up, it is absolutely perfect for us to realize that Jesus was crucified the same day that the lamb were killed, and much more importantly, he was also crucified the same hour. He was crucified on the 14th day, crucified on the 10th day, and his body was not broken. And in the same hour, if you go and check the book of Mark chapter 15, now it was the third hour when they crucified him. The third hour, if you go to Exodus 12 or so, the third hour was when they're supposed to crucify or sacrifice the lamb. And it was important for us to bear in mind that even in the night hour, he died of his own accord. His body was not broken, because the Passover lamb was not meant to be broken. None of his bone must be broken. So Jesus' bone was not broken. None of his part was broken. Praise the name of the Lord. So God clearly showing us the example that the lamb also must be fully eaten. None must be taken to the next day. Every of the lamb must be consumed. Jesus poured the totality of his being. He was on the cross and he said it was finished. He emptied himself, dying for the sin of the whole world. Jesus Christ, our sacrificial lamb, allowed himself to be fully consumed for our sin. And his body was taken down, wrapped, and buried. Praise the name of the Lord. In 1 Corinthians 15:20-23, we can see here clearly how the dead and Jesus became our first fruit of those who have fallen and who have died. Praise the name of the Lord. So, as we round up, the lamb in Egypt foretold the lamb of God. And the blood of the lamb in Egypt kept death out. But the blood of Jesus did not just keep death out of the way, but he also did what opened doors to eternal life for us. And we can see that in John 1:12, like I mentioned earlier on, he gave them power to become Son of God. In John 1:29, Jesus said what? That he has come to take away the sin of the world. If you also look at John 19, verse 6, Pilate told them there was nothing in him to be crucified. There was no fault in Jesus. The bridegroom, which is the church, you and I, we must get to that point where we must of necessity be without blemish, without wrinkle, without spot. That is what Christ had died for. In 1 Peter 1:13-16, I won't read that. You sign there that God said he is a holy God, and if you are going to be God's children, we must also be holy. So the significance of the shed blood is such that the blood must be perfect, and it must be what? Without any spot. So the blood that makes atonement for our lives and our sin is the blood of Jesus. In Leviticus 17 verse 11, we see in there that the blood makes atonement for our sin and for our lives. As I round up, I've said that severally, the flesh and the blood, basically is the blood of the flesh is in the blood. The blood of the lamb is actually what makes atonement for our sin. And the blood of Jesus is what actually delivers us as children of God. So the flesh of the lamb of Jesus Christ, the flesh of the lamb, we stand for the body of Christ, was crucified for us. Jesus is the bread of life. And the fire there is actually meant to roast the lamb. And the fire now is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit stands to consume everything that we bring before it. It's like fire. If you remember what happened in Acts 2, when the Holy Ghost came upon the people of there, it became what? It came upon them like a cloud of fire. Jesus said in Matthew 3, he said, I baptize you with water upon repentance, but there's one that will come after me. In Matthew 3, 11, he said, you shall baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. So the fire of God consumed the lamb of God. Praise the name of the Lord. And the Holy Spirit is doing that work in our life. In conclusion, year after year, Passover reminds us as God's people of God's faithfulness. And in this society and time we live, God has proved over and over again that he's God that delivers and he's God that will save us, provided we can put our trust in him. We can trust in the finished work of Christ on the cross of Calvary. The Passover is significant for us today as it was to them then, and we can continue to walk in that ultimate Passover lamb that Jesus Christ has done for us in terms of dying for us to redeem us from our sin. In conclusion, Father in heaven, we pray for today. I thank you, Lord, for the word that we have read. We thank you, Lord, for the Passover reminds us of your faithfulness. Father in heaven, we pray, King of glory, that you will deliver us as you deliver in terms of what in the name of Jesus. As we go through your word every now and then, Lord, cause us to have understanding in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray, King of glory, that the grace of God, the total package in the Passover lamb that Jesus Christ had come to give to us, we will walk in them in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Daddy, because of your blood that cleanses us from every unrighteousness. We give you all the praise, honor, adoration because you are a faithful God. In Jesus' precious name, we are praying with thanksgiving. Kindly listen to the following announcements as we go on. Faith Clean holds every Thursday by 6:30. On Sunday, we have 3 services. The first service, which is the youth service, starts at 7:30. The second service will be by 9:15. And the third service starts at 10:45. Please make time to attend. Church has opened up. We have opened and we encourage every one of us to join us. As many of us that joined, the Lord bless us as we do so in Jesus' name. Let's not forget to give our offering and tithe and all other offering to God. When we give to God, we get ourselves positioned to be blessed by God. And as we do this, the Lord will bless us indeed in Jesus' name. Please stay safe, stay strong, and stay blessed. The Lord will keep you, preserve you. None of us will be missing at the end of it in the name of Jesus. Let's share the grace in fellowship. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us now and forevermore. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.